For learning to draw, one needs to have spontaneity and flow in the lines. One should randomly keep on making circles, leaving the hand free or without any restrictions. Gradually, out of many circles, one can choose the best one and turn it into any shape one wants. In drawing eyes, the circle includes the eyelid and the puffy area under the eye too. Draw first eye shape in geometrical way. Triangles, cylinders and cubes will form the external structure of the eye. There are different types of eyes. The shape of the eye also changes as per placement of pupil. The angle will change. The shape will contract or widen as per the expression of the eye. The first eye had a straight line. This one has angular eyelid. In the first one, both the sides of the eye are even, whereas in the second, the left corner is narrower than the right side. Again, the flow of lines is created by circles to prepare a base for third shape of an eye. The third shape will get thin towards right side and wider towards left, unlike the second eye. When one draws a line joining the two edges of the eye, one can easily make out where the pupil will lie in center, slightly up the center line or slightly lower. A little shade on the side can make one visualize the actual shape of an eye. After understanding the basic shape of an eye through geometrical forms, one can easily grasp the realistic look of an eye. Practicing the same formula of creating an eye in a circle, again start circular scribbling. Draw the line in a smooth flow, trying to catch the shape of front eye. After drawing the shape of an eye, draw eyelid too. one can see the difference in hard lines of geometrical eyes and flowing lines of realistic eye. In the center of the eye, make a very small circle and leave it white. Darken the area around it. The star contrast highlights the little white spot. One needs to know that the area touching the eyelid is always darker than the color of the eyeball or pupil. Lightly start shading the pupil, the outer line slightly darker than the main area of pupil. This adds glaze to the eye. A thin line under the eye will add another dimension. And then the dark tone of eyebrow will highlight the eye more. Hiran Power once said, "The eye is the window of the soul, the mouth the door." The intellect, the will are seen in the eye. The emotions, sensibilities and affections in the mouth. The animals look for man's intentions right into his eyes. Even a rat, when you hunt him and bring him to bay, looks you in the eye. Another play of circular movement from outer circle leading to the center, automatically creating an illusion of pupil. Following the shape of geometrical eye, draw the second eye with slightly raised eyelid and wider than the previous one. The simplified form will lead an artist to the path of the realistic expression. Emerson said, "Pupil forget that it is the eye which makes the horizon, and the rounding mind's eye which makes this or that man a type or representative of humanity with the name of hero or saint." From the expression of an eye, one can guess if it's happy, sad, pensive, serious, angry, etc. The shape of the eye can easily twist the expression. The eye can turn from normally looking to starting one with just one angular outline. Shading has to be done in the same way. keeping one white dot confined in another dark circle, and then lightly shaded pupil. A little shading outside the eye adds depth to the bag, which holds the eye. One needs to be observant of the shape of an eye, as that helps a lot in bringing out character of a man. Without any other features, I can speak volume. One can peep into the soul by a glance at eyes. Tuckerman very beautifully expressed, "The eye speaks with a eloquence and truthfulness surpassing speech." It is the window out of which the winged thoughts often fly unwittingly. It is the tiny magic mirror on whose crystal surface the mood of feeling fitfully play, like the sunlight and shadow on a still stream. Exploring the shape of an eye more, draw an eye looking sideways. The eyelid will become short at the top and elongated on side. The eyeball will have a curved line, darken the center of the pupil and again shade the remaining area with a lighter tone. Till now, every eye drawn is a different angle and varied look. Practice only can strengthen the hold of an artist over the subject. With practicing only, the mind starts perceiving the dimensions and explores the creative strategy of simplification and intricate observation. Explore the drawing of an eye in another shape. The angular eyelid will add another character to it. It can turn out to be gloomy or even dreamy. Camille Pissarro aptly said, "It is only by drawing often, drawing everything, drawing incessantly, that one fine day you discover to your surprise that you have rendered something in its true character." Thank you. After darkening the pupil, defining the shape of the eye will bring out the exact character. A little shading in the eyeball. Over the eyelid and the circle encircling the shape brings out the intensity of the expression and reflects the feeling which needs no words. Till now the eyes drawn have been very calm, stable, mellowed down and dreamy. Now let's try a horrified expressions. In a normal eye, the pupil is slightly hidden under the line of eyelid, but in terrified look. The whole pupil gets centrally placed and are fully visible. By darkening the line under the eyelid, another depth crops up. It will highlight the winded look of eyeball. A little shading around the eye confines it in circular shape, and one can easily make out the expression being reflected in the eye. Eyes can reflect vulnerability, tenderness, fear, and beauty of the soul. Amedeo Modigliani said, "When I know your soul, I will paint your eyes." One needs to keep on drawing different shapes of eye. Wide, narrow, close set, deep set, round, protruding, droopy, almond shaped, etc. Various codes describe the value of the eyes. Eyes are something which needs no words to express. For instance, Du Barata said, "Those lovely lamps, these windows of the soul." L. E. Landon, "Eyes that droop like summer flowers." Thank you. Shakespeare. Disdain and scorn bright sparkling in her eyes. Edison, love, anger, pride, and avarice all visibly move in those little orbs. Southwell, her eye in silence hath a speech which I best understands. Alphonse Kerr, woman's glances express what they dare not speak. George Eliot, a super sad resolve will betray itself in the eyes. Another important facial features to study is lips. Lips also have their own language. They are also of varied shapes: wrinkled, drooping, thin, uneven, thin or thick upper or lower lip, full lips, etc. Start exploring the simplified form of lips by drawing them in geometrical shapes. The straight line will play the role of the line which is formed when two lips, upper and lower, meet. The first lip is front-facing lips with evenly shaped mountains depicting upper lip and boat-shaped lower lip. Those angles keep on changing as the lips keep on turning sideways. One side of lip will keep on getting long and the inward turn one keeps on turning short. By the time the lips totally turn to profile, just one triangle is visible for upper lip. These geometrical readings helps on artists to study in simplification and analyze what a feature will look like when in different angles. The center part of the lips being raised catches the light, that's why they are lighter and the shading is just being done on the sides of the lips. The dark lines are giving lips hard look, but moment one start drawing them realistically, the pencil automatically goes soft in strokes and one can feel the softness of the skin of the lips. The sharp angles of geometrical shape will now convert to soft and round shapes. The base will be the already explored one, but the form will be more realistic with lighter and darker shading. Now an artist knows which part of darken and which to keep lighter in shade. The upper lip is always darker than the lower one. The top lip has its characteristic bow shape, which varies considerably from person to person. The bottom is usually larger than the top and more creased with vertical stretch lines. The upper lip slopes inwards and is normally darker in tone as it is shaded from the light. The lower lip is more fleshy with a stronger muscular structure. It tends to catch the light and is further distinguished by the shadow below its pouting form. In the final stages of drawing the mouth, tone is used to soften the edges and refine the detail. Not only should it highlight the surface texture of the skin, but it should also make you more aware of the muscular structure that lies beneath. There is a subtle softening around the edges of the lips, which helps to blend them comfortably into the face. How the detail at each corner of the mouth diffuses into a small area of tone. The lip in 3/4 profile will take a softer look in the drawing. The line joining two lips together will be darkest at the inward and raised part of the lip will be emphasized with lighter and middle tones of shading. one can see the contrast of hardness and tender look in two drawings. Initially, all these studies appear to restraining and mechanical to the artist. But gradually, with practice, mind can itself guess where to turn the line and apply shade to create proper impression. Like Balthus says, one must always draw with the eyes when one cannot draw with a pencil. The lips in full profile will appear like a sleeping heart, where the second side of the lips gets totally hidden. After learning the basic shapes of the lips, one needs to study how they would appear when smiling. In smiling lips, the middle line joining the two lips together will take upward, turn curve. The drooping lips will have curved, bent downwards, upper lip getting thin and lower lip fuller. A shape like W is the shape of the chin when seen from downwards. This is another angle to study the lips. As the whole perspective changes and the shape totally changes its original appearance. The next facial feature which determines the character is nose. This part of the face can also be studied from different angles, just like lips. Just like lips, nose also has numerous dimensions to it. The center bone is the hardest part of the nose, and around its base the nostrils are placed. So while simplifying the shape of nose is geometrical way, one needs to read three angles. The rectangular bone and two triangular sides of the nose. the nostrils form another two triangles. While adding circles to the shape, the bigger one is on the lip of central bone and two smaller ones hold the curves of the nostrils. As the nose gets turned more and more sideways, one nostril keeps on reducing in size and turning half moon. The nose of side facing face has just two circles, one on tip of the nose and the second one of single nostril visible. When one observes the nose from the lower angle, the drawing suddenly gets very complicated and different. The curves change, the nostrils become the highlight. There is foreshortening of nose. The bulge of three circles become the crucial thing of study. One needs to block the series of curved planes of the nose with its appropriate tone, giving it a three-dimensional form by strength and subtlety of the tone. Variation of shading only helps in taking the drawing to a next mature level. One needs to study the prominent characteristics of the nose, if it's small, medium or long. How are the nostrils placed? Widely or clinging, the nose's central bone. One cannot learn this in a class. Observation of shapes and sizes, bone structure and muscles is very important to understand any features. An impression of movement can be achieved by series of shapes. None of them needs to be thin, sharp or linear, but collectively they can suggest sequence, direction or thrust. Line in general represents the viewer's conclusion, a set of forms in going somewhere. Now is the time to draw the nose with a smooth line instead of hard edges. After being aware of all the details which form a nose, it gets easier to grant it a realistic shape. The hard edges will turn to soft and curved lines, and the basic shape will help in molding the form, devoid of all the geometrical inputs. Mind can guess the areas to be shaded and with what intensity as per ups and downs of the planes of the nose. The light will fall maximum on a raised part like the central nasal bone and nostrils. The shading will be darker the sides of the nose, and darkest will be that of nostrils. One can shade behind the bigger circle, differentiating between the circles of nostrils and that of central bone circle. Automatically the shape will get defined with all its indentations, angles and depth. One can imagine the bone structure and muscles leading to formation of a nose. The lines of shading have to be softer on the angles, as subtle strokes will later on get blended with the tones of the face and become a part of it. Slowly and slowly, with patience and continuous pencil scribble, shading will keep on gaining variation and adding more depth to the drawing. Realization of internal as well as external structure will come in the artist, and he will start looking at a familiar object in different light. Another significant part of the heads is ears. Like nose, even ears have many curves to explore and study. Ears also have different shapes like round, square, pointed and narrow, and with free attached or even broad lobe. The depths of ear, starting from outer bone to inside, includes of helix, superior crus, inferior crus, scapha, antihelix, tragus, antitragus, the inside depth, concha, and then lobule. The ear is a complicated arrangement of ripple and folds of flesh. You need to organize its irregular shape into some basic forms that are easier to outline. You can then use this linear framework to gradually build up its complex form with tone. Simplify the tonal structure of the ear into three areas. Number one, area that are mostly light, leaves these unshaded. Number two, areas that are mostly dark, shade these with mid-tone. Number three, areas that are externally dark, shade these with dark tone. Look deeply into each area of tone and try to pick up on the subtle variations that lie within. You may have a darken some of the light areas and lighten some of the dark areas to achieve a balance of tone. Tonal drawing is simply a balancing act between the elements of light and shade. In fact, all drawing is a constant balance between your observation, your concentration, your judgment, and your technique. After drawing the left ear, try the right one. The indentations will remain same, but the length of lobe and cutter curve might change as per the shape. The lobe might hang a little and the curves of the ear can turn round instead of angular. The angular variations of shading can enhance a few parts of the ear and even take the vision deep into the depth of the ear. Vertical, horizontal, angular lines can depict numerous levels of the formation of the ear. Another experiment with the ear can be done from another angle, where one can see the slight curve of behind the ear area. The ear appears narrow but elongated at lobe. As one keeps on practicing, more and more vision is enriched and one loves to explore new dimensions. Vic Munich very aptly expressed the process of drawing. Drawing is not only a way to educate your eye to understand visual information, organizing it into a more hierarchical way. A more economical way. When you see something, if you draw often and frequently, you examine a room very differently.